Ezekiel chapter 38. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against Gog, the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and prophesied against him, Gog the man. Gog is the man, Magog is the land. And say, Thus saith the Lord God, Behold, I am against thee, O Gog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and I will turn thee back and put hooks into thy jaws. Where has that been mentioned before? Leviathan. And I will bring thee forth, and all thy army, horses and horsemen, all of them clothed with all sorts of armor. Now they're dressed for success, but not against God. Even a great company with bucklers and shields, all of them handling swords. You know, you can have all the advance of armament, artillery, and armor, and missiles, and everything. If God's against you, you just want to strip out in the battlefield, bare naked, and just take your punishment. Persia, Iran, Iraq area, Ethiopia, and Libya, that's Africa, with them, all of them with shield and helmet. You know somebody else who had a shield and didn't wear his helmet? Goliath. Gomer. That's not Gomer Pyle. Gomer and all his bands, the house of Tugarmiah of the north quarter, and all his bands, and many people with... There's an ecumenical movement of an army here. Gog, Ethiopia, Libya... Be thou prepared and prepare for thyself, thou. Now he's speaking against Gog. And all thy company that are assembled unto thee, and be thou a guard unto them. Protect me. After many days thou shalt be visited. In the latter years thou shalt come into the land that is brought back from the sword, and is gathered out of many people, against the mountains, Revelation 19, against the Lord, against Jezreel, Revelation 19:16 and 17:13, against the mountains of Israel. Well, here's a bunch of people going against the Jews again, which have been always waste. I thought we read in the last chapter that Israel's fine, all the mountains are doing great, and their blessings. Not yet. But it is brought forth out of the nations, and they shall dwell safely, all of them. After the attack on the mountains, after all the judgment upon the mountains. Thou shalt ascend and come like a storm. Thou shalt be like a cloud to cover the land. Thou and all thy bands, many people with thee. Cloud you can't see. Dust cloud. Big stormy clouds. Thus saith the Lord God, it shall also come to pass that at the same time shall things come into thy mind, and thou shalt think an evil thought. And thou shalt say, I will go up to the land of unwalled villages. I will go to them that are rest, that dwell safely, all of them dwelling without walls, and having neither bars nor gates, they're unprotected, to take spoil, and just go through the city, the town, take whatever you can find, and to take prey, captives, people, to turn thy hand upon the desolate places that are now inhabited, and upon the people that are gathered out of the nation, which have gotten cattle and goods, that dwell in the midst of the land. I'm going to go in these areas and just devour and take and steal and Sheba and Dedan, and the merchants of Tarshish, with all the young lions thereof, shall say unto thee, Art thou come to take a spoil? Hast thou gathered thy company to take a prey? to carry away silver and gold, to take away cattle and goods, to take a great spoil. Somebody's coming to loot a land. And the land has much riches, much goods. Therefore, son of man, prophesy, say unto God, the man, thus saith the Lord God, in that day when my people of Israel dwell safely, shalt thou not know it. Uh-oh. God is not going to be in the millennium. Because that's when the Jews dwell safely. And thou shalt come from thy place out of the north part, thou and many people with thee, all them ruling upon horses, a great company and mighty army. God has destroyed many armies. And thou shalt come up against my people of Israel. Uh-oh. A curse will be upon him. As a cloud to cover the land, it shall be in the latter days. And I will bring thee against my land. Tell that to the United Nations. Tell that to the Arabians. That the heathen may know me, when I shall be sanctified in thee, O God, Gog, before their eyes. When God gets victory over Gog, they're going to say, wow. You know how mighty this God's going to be? In order for God to get rid of him, they're going to all wonder. Thus saith the Lord God, art thou he of whom I have spoken in old time by my servants, the prophets of Israel, which prophesied in those days many years that I would bring thee against them? And it shall come to pass at the same time when Gog shall come against the land of Israel, saith the Lord God, that my fury shall come up in my face. Daniel 11:41-45. For in my jealousy, there's that jealousy again, and in the fire of my wrath, and we read about that the other night, have I spoken. So God, the consuming fire, is angry with Gog. Surely in that day there shall be a great shaking, Haggai 2:6, in the land of Israel, so that the fishes of the sea, Mediterranean Sea, I assume, and the fowls of the heaven, and the beasts of the field, and all creepy things that creep along the earth, upon the earth, and all the men that are upon the face of the earth shall shake at my presence. Now, when is that? That is the second advent of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the mountains shall be thrown down, and the steep places shall fall, and every wall shall fall to the ground at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know how they know that God is the Lord? Because the Lord Jesus Christ will be judging everyone that has cursed the Jews, and they'll be cast into hell. That's how you're going to know. That sword, that flame that comes out of his mouth. I will call for a sword against him throughout all my mountains. It's the word. Revelation 16:14-19, 11-21. Saith the Lord God, every man's sword shall be against his brother. A civil war in the ranks of the army. They're going to kill each other. That already happened one time in the Bible. An army came up to fight another army, and the enemy started devouring each other. It's going to happen again. You know why you read your Bible? Because it's going to happen again. Jesus Christ came the first time. He's coming again. God made the heavens and earth. He's going to get rid of them and remake them. I will plead against him with pestilence. And there's just a bunch. 1 Chronicles 21:12, verse 16, Second Chronicles 32:21, Second Kings 19:35, Zechariah 14:12-15. And we read it with Jeremiah, we've read it with Ezekiel, and with blood, killing. And I will rain upon him, and upon his bands, upon the many people that are with him, an overflowing rain. It's going to flood them out. And great hailstones, like in Sodom and Gomorrah with Lot's time. Fire, like Sodom and Gomorrah, Lot's time. And brimstone, Revelation 8:7. Thus will I magnify myself and sanctify myself, and I will be known in the eyes of many nations, and they shall know that I am the Lord. Well, look at that. We got one more chapter. In chapter 40, we pick up, Lord willing, the millennial kingdom. We're coming to the age of man fallen. Now, let me read a note here. Not very few do I read, but let me read a note in here by C.I. Schofield. Give him the credit. Now, I don't know who these people are, but where I can borrow brains, I will borrow brains. This is what C.I. Schofield wrote. And this is what, let's see if I can check out the copyright date here. Just find it real quick. I won't find it, I'll just read. Well, before 1917, it's copyright. I don't see a copyright. There is a copyright for C.I. Schofield. I'm going to give him the credit for what is being said now. Before 1917. I got a date here. Something like that. Talking about God. That the primary reference is to the northern European power, headed up by Russia. All agree. Not all agree, but I'm reading the note as it is. The whole passage should be read in connection with Zechariah 12, 1-4, 14, 1-9, Matthew 24, 14-30, Revelation 14, 14-20, 19, 17, 21. God is the prince, Magog is his land. The reference to Meshach and Tubal, Moscow, and Tobolsk is a clear mark of identification, as he says. Russia and the northern powers have been the latest persecutors of dispersed Israel, and is congruous both with divine judgment and with the covenants, Genesis 15:18, Deuteronomy 30:3, that destruction should fall at the climax of the last mad attempt to exterminate the remnant of Israel in Jerusalem. At the second advent of the Lord Jesus Christ, just before that happens, they're going to try to get rid of every single Jew they can with ultimate force. Revelation 12 says Satan has fallen from heaven and he knows he has but a little time. He swallows up the Jordan River in an effort to kill every Jew. That Antichrist wants to kill every single American. That Antichrist wants to kill every English-born... That Antichrist wants to kill every Roman... That Antichrist wants to kill every single Jew. You know, Adolf Hitler also picked on other races besides the Jews. The Antichrist will be out for the Jews and nothing but the Jews. And the only way he'll go after you if you defend and protect the Jews. The whole prophecy belongs to the yet future, the day of Jehovah, Isaiah 2:10-22, Revelation 19:11-21, and to the battle of Armageddon, Revelation 16:14-19:19, but includes also the final revolt of the nations at the close of the kingdom age, Revelation 20:7-9. Now, you know what's remarkable about that note I just read? Today we look at Moscow with the Cold War and Russia as ultimate high degree mean nations, powerful nations. And yet, in 1909, Russia wasn't even nobody. They haven't even begun their powers yet. And C.I. Schofield writes a passage to say that this country is going to be in full power and full alliance. Now, is it going to be Russia? I don't know. I thought it was an interesting note that he spoke of a nation that wasn't even really a nation yet. But let it be known one thing out of this chapter. It's going to be a seeking a power of elimination of every single Jew. Satan has been against that Jew since Abram. They're God's people. They are God's nation. And who else is everyone going to hate? So as a Christian, if you do right, marvel not the world hates you. Know that all they that live godly shall suffer persecution. You are in great company. When you mark, how much the world hates the Jews, how much does the world hate you? In the end, there are three salvations. That of belief on the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, that's the church. Obeying the law and doing the works of the law, being in complete obedience to God, Old Testament, tribulation, the Jews, the Gentiles, their conduct to the Jews in the tribulation period will get them into the millennium. Now, whatever happened before the law, before Exodus 20, I have no idea. But I know Abraham is saved because he was in Abraham's bosom. I believe Naaman got saved. But he was after the law. Nebuchadnezzar got saved. What do you do with Abel? Where did he go? How did he go? Where did Noah go? He didn't believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and he and his house were saved. He built a boat. But there are two classes of people in the Bible. Jews and the church. And the world hates them both. And if you are in repetition and reputation and any other R word of respect of the world, you ain't doing nothing right.